Hello, friends, and welcome back. We started looking at the goodness of God yesterday, and I want to pick up in Hebrews chapter 9, starting in verse 11. We've talked about the eternal redemption provided for us in Jesus Christ. Let's pick up there and see what he has for us today. It says, "But Christ, being come a high priest of good things to come, by greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained an eternal redemption for us." Jesus is the high priest of good things that God wants to manifest in your life, is what we see here. We see that it was by his blood that he presented on the heavenly mercy seat, on the heavenly altar, that he obtained an eternal redemption for you. There, Paul tells us in Romans chapter 8 and verse 1, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. We've talked about in the previous videos the positional revelation, gaining an understanding of who we are in Christ Jesus. In Romans chapter 8, it says there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. There are a lot of Christians today who have been sealed into Christ. They've been made into new creations, as Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. They are new creatures in him, but they live in condemnation. Why? Because they do not have a revelation and they do not operate and function out of their position in Christ Jesus. There is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, but there is a lot of condemnation for those who are operating out of their position in Christ. In Christ, you have been made accepted in the Beloved. In Christ, you have an eternal redemption. You are complete in Christ. You were created in righteousness and pure holiness when you accepted Jesus. And then God tells us here in verse 11, "But Christ being made a high priest, the good things to come." God has a great plan for you, has good things for you. But then it goes on to say, "For by the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean, sanctifying to the purifying of the flesh, how much more through the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God." Purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Your conscience is the voice of your spirit. Your spirit has been recreated into a new species of being that did not exist, as one translation says. You were buried in Christ, but a new creature, a new creation came forth from that grave. One that was sealed in Christ. One that had the redemption of sins, the forgiveness of sins. Your redemption was completed before you were ever born. Jesus obtained that eternal redemption. And again, I've said several times, as you go through the New Testament, you hear people talk about needing to ask him to forgive their sins. And as you go through the New Testament, the one thing you're going to see is it doesn't tell you to ask for forgiveness. Why is that? You see, your forgiveness was sealed with the blood of Jesus before you took your first breath. Every mistake, every sin, everything you do wrong, every wrong thought was forgiven before you committed it, before you thought it, before you acted on it. Your forgiveness is complete because of the blood of Jesus, because he presented his blood and obtained that eternal redemption. Past, present, future, every sin was forgiven. Let me give you an example of this. In Acts chapter 16, verse 25, we have a story talking about Paul and Silas. They're in prison. It's a really bad situation. We talked about in the previous video, the darkness, the evil manifesting around us. God has good plans for us. And when you understand who you are in Christ, when you begin to operate out of that position of who you have been made in him, you will stop looking externally and just start looking internally, because the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is dwelling within your spirit. Paul and Silas could have been sitting there looking at each other. Oh, this is so bad. We're chained up. It's all over. We're going to die. But they didn't focus on the evil, the bad. They focused on God's goodness. They understood that Jesus was their high priest of good things to come. They understood that even though things didn't look so good, you know, they were in chains, they were in prison, but in the midst of it, they understood that they served a good God who had a good plan and had good things planned out for them. So instead of complaining, instead of looking around the situation around them, it says they prayed and sang praises unto God. Now they didn't sing quietly. It says the other prisoners heard them as they sang praises unto God. In the midst of the darkness around us, we can sing praises to God. In the midst of our worst timing, we can sing praises to God. People should see a difference in us because we serve a God with a good plan, and we know that He has good things planned for their lives as well. You may have unsaved loved ones, you may have unsaved co-workers, but God has a good plan for them. Jesus obtained an eternal redemption for them, just as He obtained an eternal redemption for you. The difference between you and them, if you're a Christian watching this video, is that they just haven't accepted that free gift of salvation. But in His mind, they are forgiven. That redemption was sealed before they were born, just as it was sealed for you. So Paul and Silas are praying and singing praises to God, and the prisoners heard them. And notice in verse 26, suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed. Can you imagine what that looked like? Can you imagine being in that situation? See, the Bible doesn't tell us that being in Christ means you will never have a symptom, that you'll never have a trial, that you'll never have a situation that you need to walk through. Paul told Timothy to fight the good fight of faith. You see, our fight is not to gain something from God, because everything has been provided by God. So if the provision has been given, then really our fight is a transforming, the renewing of our minds with the Word of God to what has been provided in Christ Jesus, who is the high priest of good things to come. You see, God has a good plan for you. He has a good, good plan for you. He only wants good things for your life. But the reality is, we live in a dark and sinful world. We see the manifestation of evil all around us. In Psalm 23, which was a prophetic utterance of the day we live in, the psalmist said, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." He didn't say we'd stop and camp. He said we walk through it. Because in the midst of that valley, what does our heavenly God, our heavenly Father do? He puts a table. He sets a table before us in the presence of our enemies. He didn't say there wouldn't be any enemies. He didn't say that there wouldn't be evil things happening around us. He didn't say there wouldn't be darkness around us. But in the midst of it all, He sets a table before us in the presence of our enemies. Paul and Silas, they understood this. So in the midst of it all, knowing that God had set a table of provision before them, chose to praise their good God and their high priest who had good things planned for them, because they knew in Christ they had a plan, and it was not over at that moment. I mean, think about it. What is the absolute worst that can happen in situations like this? You leave this world and you end up with your heavenly Father in heaven for eternity. God has good plans. The absolute worst the devil can do is put you in the presence of your heavenly Father for eternity. You're an eternal being with a good plan. So there was an earthquake. The foundation of the prison were shaken. Everyone's bands were broke. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had fled. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, "Do thyself no harm, for we are here." I can just imagine the other prisoners' reaction to this. They were all probably going, like, these people were just singing, and all of a sudden all the doors popped open, all the chains fell off their arms. Can you imagine how shocking that must have been? Can you imagine being in the midst of that and seeing God do something like that? Talk about getting an unbeliever's attention. God has a way of doing it. Then he called for a light, talking about the jailer. He called for a light, sprang in, and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. He brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Now, I want you to notice Paul's response here. I've told you, the Bible does not tell us to ask for forgiveness of our sins. That's a new wrinkle on things. That's a new way of looking at things. The reason is because your sin was forgiven before you even committed it, because Jesus obtained an eternal redemption for you. You were forgiven. You were complete in Him. You were chosen to be holy without blame before Him from the foundation of the world, before God even said, "Light be," as we see in Genesis chapter 1. He had already chosen you. He had already chosen me. He had already chosen the unsaved people you come into contact with to receive redemption and forgiveness of their sins. That work was complete, but now it's a matter of us accepting it. And it's interesting what Paul says here. He says, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" In verse 31, he said, "They said, believe on the Lord Jesus, and thou and thy house shalt be saved. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house." But notice what Paul tells them: believe on the Lord. Believe on the Lord. Your redemption is complete. God is offering a free gift of salvation. If you're watching this video and you have never ask Jesus to be the Lord of your life, Paul's instructions to the jailer are just as pertinent to you as they were to the jailer so many years ago. Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you shall be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you shall be saved. Doesn't take a lot of effort. Doesn't take a lot of work. Religion will make it sound a lot more difficult than it is. But the truth is, your redemption was completed before you were ever born. And now it's just a matter of you believing on the Lord Jesus. Jesus wants to be your best friend. Jesus is the high priest of good things to come. Jesus wants to provide for you. Jesus wants to take care of you. But it's a matter of you accepting that free gift of salvation. Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you shall be saved. Paul didn't tell him to fast, to pray, to cry out to God for forgiveness. Paul just said, believe on the Lord Jesus, and you shall be saved. Salvation is a free gift. Jesus obtained an eternal redemption for us. Jesus presented His blood. He knew that you and I had nothing in ourselves. We didn't have the ability to save ourselves. We didn't have the ability within ourselves because we were sinners by birth. And we're going to take a look at it in some of the future videos. But if you go into Romans chapter 5 and read through that, one thing you'll see, we were sinners not because of anything we did. We were sinners because Adam and Eve sinned. And by association, every single human being that has lived since has been a sinner. But now, you are not the righteousness of God in yourself because of anything you do. It's all because of what Jesus did. So we were all plunged into sin. We were all plunged into evil. We were all plunged into all these things. Not because of anything we did, but because of what Adam did. But in the same sense, we are made new creations in Christ Jesus. We were made, in Ephesians 4, it talks about we're made righteous and purely holy, not because of anything we did, but because of Jesus. Believe on the Lord Jesus and you shall be saved. We've talked about the good things that he has. Let's look again in 2 Peter. It says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge and of Jesus our Lord. According as his divine power, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby within the knowledge of him are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these we might become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption of the world through lust. We've escaped the corruption of the world through the knowledge of him. We believe on the Lord Jesus. We are saved. We become a new creation in Christ Jesus. He becomes the high priest of good things to come because he obtained that eternal redemption. We are sealed in him by the Holy Spirit. We are made accepted in the beloved. We are created righteous and pure holiness. We obtain redemption in him, all because of his actions, not because of ours. That is why it is as simple as believe on the Lord Jesus. He has made provision for us. He planned out good things for us. It says, he has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness through the knowledge of him that called us unto glory and virtue. You see, people struggle, Christians struggle, because they are not picking up the word and giving it the place that it deserves in their lives. Because we're not meditating, focusing, thinking on, pondering, giving careful and considerate attention to the word of God on a day-by-day basis. Everything has already been supplied. Every provision that includes healing, that includes deliverance, that includes faith, that includes prosperity, peace, grace. It's all multiplied in our life through the knowledge of him. That's why I've said so many times in Romans 12, 1 and 2, we have the foundational actions that are required of us. Presenting our bodies as living sacrifices and then becoming transformed by the renewing of our minds. The renewing of our minds is key because we already have everything supplied in Christ Jesus. We have that same power that raised Jesus from the dead. We're not waiting for revival. God is waiting for us to renew our minds, to transform our souls with his word, and to begin to step into all of his promises. He has called us to walk in his goodness on a day-by-day basis. The church today is not reaching the world as he desires for us to reach the world because we are not presenting his goodness to the world. We live just like those around us. We struggle just like those around us, but we have a hope within us. He has already made the provision, but we need a revelation of who we are in Christ Jesus. Jesus wants to be your high priest of good things to come. What are those good things? That's a manifestation of his healing power. That's a manifestation of his delivering power. That's a manifestation of his goodness through you. In Mark chapter 16, Jesus told his disciples that those who believe shall speak with new tongues. They shall lay hands on the sick, and the sick shall recover. We have the power within us. We're not waiting for him to pour out the power. He's waiting for us to gain a revelation of who we are in Christ Jesus, and to begin to walk in what has already been provided. But doing so will require us to get in the Word, to spend time meditating on the truths of the Word, allowing the Word to wash us with its water, wash our souls, take out those old thought patterns and replace them with his thought patterns so that we can begin to walk and be the men and women of God that he has called us to be. We are called to be salt and light in this world. We are called to walk in his power. We are called to walk in his purpose. But this will require us to gain a revelation of who we are in him. In him, you are amazing. in him you are complete, and he has only good things planned for your life. What are you going to do with it? That is really the question. Because our problem in the lack of manifestation in our lives is due to our lack of revelation of who we are in Christ Jesus. Our time is up today. I thank you for joining me. I encourage you, take the word, especially in Ephesians. We've looked at it through these videos. Find out what it tells you about who you are in Christ. Write them out. Meditate on them. Think about them. Let them become revelation knowledge. Let him wash you with the water of his word. But he can't do that if you're not looking at his word on a day-by-day basis. Please let us know if there's anything we can stand with you in prayer. And until the next video, God bless.